Beast is pretty much everybody's favourite X-Men, unless they prefer Wolverine. He's like, he's up
yeah.
there.
Yeah, he is a very popular character. I mean, I remember when I first got cast the role, you know, lots of my mates are big X-Men fans and sent me messages saying, well done, and also, you know, don't mess this up, because, you know, we're a big X-Men fans and the character is a great one.
Did you have to do any kind of research? I mean, you're playing basically one of the smartest guys in the world, so did you, you know, start sitting down and trying to read Plato or something?
Well, actually, I am one of the smartest men in the world already, so
typecasting.
It's a pain, really. The research side of things was, you know, Matthew was a fan of what Kelsey did with the role, and Kelsey's already seen, because Fraser is a very intelligent man, and he kind of already had that persona, so... you know, I watched some of his stuff and drew slightly on his accent. For this accent, it wouldn't have been correct to take it exactly, because he was playing Beast older. So this was, you know, a young scientist version of that accent. And then it was just kind of... the intelligent side was, in this, he's creating lots of inventions, the extra and stuff, are things that nowadays are actually physically maybe possible. But in the 60s, obviously, we're way ahead of their time. Yeah. And he creates some great inventions for the rest of the team.
But he's not quite the Zen master that the Beast becomes. He's a much, obviously, a younger guy, and a sort of, he's still trying to find himself, I guess.
Yeah, there's that thing, you know, everyone has a bit of teen angst, I would guess. But there's, for Beast, he's, you know, he's been very alone and hiding his mutation for years and years, and then he meets this team, and, you know, Professor X becomes a friend and and you know, someone that he can relate to, and that, you know, that they're both on a level, and he kind of trains him to control and understand the Beast side of his nature, the Jekyll and Hyde aspects of it, and also meets Mystique, Raven's character, who just makes him feel slightly at peace and has an understanding of what he feels in life.
Was there much discussion of the look? Because there have been lots of different versions of the Beast. There's been a sort of slightly more cat one, a slightly more bear one, you know, slightly more Beauty and the Beast. Was that something that was kind of settled before you came aboard, or did they have to do lots of tests on you?
Yeah, we did lots of tests and tried different things out, which was brilliant. So Matthew's responses to some of the makeups were hilarious. And Matthew, you know, he wanted something that would be quite scary and look quite vicious and more feral than the previous Beast looks from the other films. So it involved a lot of fur and big teeth, which I couldn't really talk in, and contact lenses, the works.
Would you do all of this makeup again, or are you all like, bring on the mocap, I want to just put on a suit with ping pong balls?
See, I have done the ping pong ball suit thing as well. And that, I mean, it's more comfortable and takes less time. But that's pretty weird, working in the motion capture, the volume thing, where there's nothing around you and lots of computers humming. But I think the makeup helps with this character, because, you know, otherwise you can kind of, I think you can still sense kind of being within it, hopefully.
Oh, definitely.
It's worth it.
It came across.
Okay.
All those R's weren't wasted. and obviously you've got Jack the Giant Killer coming up next. What can you tell us about that?
Jet the Giant Killer is a fairy tale directed by Bryan Singer. Basically, you know, the story of a young farm boy who falls in love with the princess, gets caught up on an epic mission to try and save her.